Good morning. My name is Sean Hudgenwardle, and I'll be your moderator for this morning's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as the result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true and correct name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted with Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted with God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted with Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles. They are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lords many and Gods many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This simply means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, the Greek, nor the Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of the Father and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit. And in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now, Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a superincorporeal being That is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also, in this school, we teach according to the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court roundabout. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called laws of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah, with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today we will have a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas. That will be followed by a selection of music. Our scripture lesson will be the second chapter of Acts, and that will be read by Dr. Eunice Reiser. Dr. Salas.
Good morning, class. Good morning. It's a time of prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for allow us to be here in the place of the highest learning. If we just put attention and what the speaker, which is Yahweh, says, we'll be encouraged and our heart will be open and learn your purpose and plan of salvation, which is very important. I say all those things and you only sign name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Good morning, class. Our scripture lesson will be taken from Acts, the second chapter, page 157. And I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts revised by the late A.B. Trainum. Acts, the second chapter. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, while they were all with one accord in one place, suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and rested upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. And there were dwellings at Jerusalem, Jews, devout men, out of every nation under heaven. Now when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and was confounded, because they, every man, heard them speak in his own language. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, Behold, are not all these which speak Galatians? And how hear we every man in our own tongue wherein we were born? Parthians and Medes and Elamites and the dwellers in Mesopotamia and in Judea and Cappadocia and Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Phlegia, in Egypt and in the parts of Libya about Syrian and strangers of Rome, Jews and proselytes. Cretes and Arabians, we do hear them speak in our tongues the wonderful works of Elohim. And they were all amazed and were in doubt, saying one to another, What meaneth this? Others mocking, saying, These men are full of new wine, are drunken. But Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, Ye men of Judea, and all ye that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and hearken to my words. For these are not drunken as ye suppose, seeing it is but the third hour of the day. But this is of that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days, saith Yahweh, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servant and on my handmaidens I will pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood, before the great and terrible day of Yahweh come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of Yahweh shall be saved. Ye men, sons of Israel, hear these words. Yahshua of Nazareth, a man approved of Yahweh among you by miracles and wonders and signs, which Yahweh did by him in the midst of you, as ye yourselves also know. Him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of Yahweh, ye have taken and by wicked hands have crucified and slain, whom Yahweh has raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be holden of it. For David speaketh concerning him, I have set Yahweh always before my face, for he is on my right hand, that I should not be moved. Therefore did my heart rejoice, and my tongue was glad. Moreover also my flesh shall rest in hope. Because thou wilt not leave my soul in Sheol, neither wilt thou suffer in thy Holy One to see corruption. Thou hast made known to me the ways of life. Thou shalt make me full of joy with thy countenance. Men and brethren, let me freely speak unto you of the patriarch David, that he is both dead and buried. His sepulchre is with us unto this day. Therefore, being a prophet, and knowing that Yahweh had sworn with an oath to him, that of the fruit of his loin, according to the flesh, he would raise up the Messiah to sit on his throne. He has seen this before, spake of the resurrection of the Messiah, that his soul was not left in Sheol, neither did his flesh see corruption. This Yahshua hath Yahweh raised up, whereof we all are witnesses. Therefore, being by the right hand of Yahweh exalted, and having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has shed forth this which ye now see and hear. For David has not ascended into the heavens, but he said himself, Yahweh said unto my Elohim, sit thou on my right hand until I make thy fold thy footstool. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that Yahweh has made the same Yahshua, whom ye have crucified, both King and Messiah. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their hearts, and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, repent, and be baptized every one of you in the name of Yahshua the Messiah for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are far off, even as many as Yahweh our Elohim shall call. And with many other words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this perverse generation. Then they that gladly received his word was baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, and in breaking of bread and in prayers. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. And all that believed were together and had all things common, and sold their possessions and goods, and parted them to all men as every man had need. And they continuing daily with one accord in the temple, and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their food with gladness and singleness of heart, praising Yahweh and having favor with all the people. And Yahweh added to the congregation daily such as were being saved. I have read Acts, the second chapter. Let us all say, hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Silas, and thank you, Dr. Reiser. Today is Sunday, and we have a lecture format today. Our first speaker for today's class will be the Dean of the Ontario Branch, Dr. Marland Love. Dr. Love?
Good morning, class. It's good to be here once again in order to learn more about the purpose and plan of Yahweh while we yet reside here on earth, when we have the opportunity to learn and know more perfectly about these things that we've come to learn to know about. And the scripture reading, thank you for reading that long chapter, if you would, Eunice, but it's the Pentecost of when Yahshua the Messiah returned into the hearts and minds of the apostles and those that were in the upper room that day in order for them to hear what thus says the Holy Spirit, when the Spirit breathed into them and resided in them and stayed in them, being the information or the knowledge of the doctrine, which is the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua Messiah, looking back according to when it began to be revealed, if you would, just as Yahweh revealed the name to Moses for the very first time when we can go to, you know, Exodus 6 and 3, where it says that they, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, didn't know the name of Yahweh. You see, that began Moses here in the fourth dispensation. And to see how it was Yahshua performing that, that at that time to give Moses that vision in the fourth dispensation, and it to correlate with that fourth day of creation when he created that sun, that S-U-N, on that fourth day. And when we see how this is lined up, and we can see how June 6th, when the children of Israel fled to and through the Red Sea and to land here on that first trip when the Ten Commandment law was passed down to the children of Israel. That was the June the 6th. It's in correlation and it's in correlation and in line with what we just read in the scriptures. Acts, the second chapter. This June 6th is the same as that June 6th when Peter stood up and expressed the things of Yahweh. And they all heard in one accord, right? Well, that was 50 days after his death, correct? Well, it's 50 days from this point by which Yahshua ushered down or spoke the word or the Ten Commandments or the law, the first law, to the children of Israel. That was 50 days after they enslaved this lamb down here in the Passover.
Right.
So these are witnesses that are on earth because that was a blood happening down here with that death of the lamb and that blood having to be struck on the lintel and the two side posts, right? Mm-hmm. And so these are witnesses that are on earth whereby we can look at, because Moses transpired. Abraham was a vision of Moses when he saw Abraham and in the generations from Adam all the way down to Pentecost. Same thing with Moses saw when he was on this mountain, that third trip. Follow? So when we see how this pattern is set up and what Yahshua is showing according to the types and shadows and the witnesses that are set up based off of time even. Mm-hmm. Because hey, this event here in this fourth dispensation with Moses coming to this bush is right on time with that sun coming. It's right on time with Yahshua Messiah coming again.
Right.
You follow? And so when we see how these witnesses are bearing the knowledge of Yahshua the Messiah and how these things are set up, we can better appreciate what Yahweh has in store for us, which is to know him, right? As he really is and actually exists, which is our first aim. Now, I'm going to grab a couple of scriptures, so just bear with me. Let's grab Revelations 1 and 5. I'm going to need Hebrews 9 and 8. I'm probably going to do a lot of scriptures, so Sean, would you mind reading a little bit maybe? What? No, that's Sean. Two Sean's in here now. Start with Revelations there, and then I'm going to do this. Just hold that, Sean.
Revelations 1 and 5?
Yes.
John, to the seven assemblies which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace from him which is and which was and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne.
Go back and read it one again. 1 and 5?
1 and 5.
Yeah.
John, to the seven assemblies which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace mm-hmm. from him which is and which was and which is to come,
mm-hmm.
and from the seven spirits which are before his throne, and from Yahshua the Messiah.
Go ahead, keep reading. That's all 5?
Revelation 1 and 5?
Mm-hmm. That's what you got, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, I was going to 6.
Yeah, see what 6 say.
And from Yahshua the Messiah, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead and the ruler of the kings of the earth.
Keep going.
unto him that loveth us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, mm-hmm. and has made us kings and priests unto mm-hmm. Yahweh his Father.
Now that's Yahshua the Messiah that John the Baptist, or John the Revelator, is talking about, right? While out here on the Isle of Patmos. He's looking at this blood line, if you would. Because these are going to be the witnesses, right? That we've come to learn line upon line, precept upon precept. Here a little, there a little. We're looking at the blood, the water, and the spirit, right? And so when we can see, when John is looking back, he's looking at this blood line, if you would. That it was Yahshua the Messiah that was set up all along in order to wash us of our sins, or of what, or who we think we are, because we all accepted that it was Adam that transgressed the law, correct, and sinned, right? And in that event, that he died in his consciousness. We've went over this in Romans 5 and 14, expresses that within Adam all men died, right? And so in that death was in their consciousness all the way until Acts the second chapter, when that was been that event of that death was exonerated, if you would. After this event, it was made available for mankind to know, not to remain dead in your consciousness. Because we know prior to this event, That was all preordained and set up for them not to know, mm-hmm. right? And so now after this, that's why Yahshua came. That's why he was the beloved of Yahweh, in order to make a way, right? The way, the truth, and the life. Meaning, you're not stuck in the old dispensation of the law,
right?
Or the fourth age, when it was already, it was preordained that Moses, that this event, this migratory pattern, was going to transpire. Now, after this was completed and Yahshua fulfilled 4,000 years of persons, places, and things, and then ushered in his Holy Spirit into the hearts and minds of man, whereby we can now know the Holy Spirit, just as Saul just wrote. Reread what Saul just wrote. Start at 5 again.
John, to the seven assemblies.
Now he's talking to the assemblies, read.
Which are in Asia,
uh-huh.
grace be unto you and peace from him, yeah. which is and which was.
Yeah, see how John the Baptist, that's the one that Sean talked about on Thursday, the one, the beloved John, when he said that he Yahshua, whom love, keep reading.
From him which is and which uh-huh, was uh-huh. and which is to come.
That's Yahshua. That's was, that is to come. Mm-hmm. That lets you know that he was way back here in the Garden of Eden.
Right.
And before that, if you would.
Right.
Who was, who is, mm-hmm. and is to come. He's talking about Yahshua the Messiah. Keep right. reading.
And from the seven spirits which are before his throne.
Uh-huh.
And from Yahshua the Messiah, who is the
faithful
witness.
Those spirits are the 7 days, if you would. Down through this 7 days of creation, 7 ages, 7 dispensations. We're talking about right. angels that have ushered in day by day. Mm-hmm. Keep reading.
And from Yahshua the Messiah.
See, he's from Yahshua the Messiah. That's the he that he's talking about. Who was, who is, and who is to come. Mm-hmm. That's Yahshua. That way, you can't just pick him up here and think he wasn't back here with Adam.
Right.
He wasn't back here with Noah. You can't think that.
Right.
If you do, you break up the continuity mm-hmm. of what John the Revelator is saying. Mm-hmm. That this Yahshua what?
Who is the faithful witness.
He's the witness. That lets you know that when we talk about blood, we're talking about witnesses. We're talking about Yahshua the Messiah. Not the events that's transpiring per se. Mm-hmm. We're talking about looking for the one to come, who is in you, meaning not coming, not I say is coming, but is in you, and that
right.
we know how to see and recognize the blood, and that what that blood is representing is Yahshua. That water is going to be Yahshua. Keep reading.
and the first begotten of the dead.
He's the first begotten of the dead. That's died. Remember, Adam died, and in Adam all men were dead from this 4,000 years, if you would, until Yahshua. And he's going to be the first that's going to raise up. Not a physical body. He's not raising up Adam's physical body. Right. He's raising up the soul that was in Adam, which was remained in repose for them some 4,000 years until his death, burial, and resurrection. And he's part of these group that ascended, Yahshua being the first fruits of them to raise. A quickening spirit according to a knowledge of Elohim, if you would. Keep reading.
The ruler of the kings of the earth.
Yahshua is the ruler of the kings of the earth. Read.
Unto him that loved us mm-hmm. and washed us from our sins mm-hmm. in his own blood.
Mm. Now, so that's that bloodline here. That's who's doing the work all the way down through the ages and dispensations. That's who we look to when we're down and we think we're dead. We don't know what to do. That's why we look to Yahshua.
Right.
Because that blood and that death is synonymous. So keep reading.
And has made us kings and priests unto Yahweh his Father.
Mm-hmm.
To him be glory and dominion forever and ever.
Now, Hebrews 9 and 18.
9 and 18 mm-hmm. or 8?
18.
Okay. Whereupon neither the first covenant was confirmed without blood. For when Moses had spoken every precept to all the people according to the law, he took the blood of calves.
Now this is Saul. This is Saul, the apostle Saul, right? Who was a persecutor of Yahshua the Messiah after the death, burial, and resurrection. Because remember, he slayed Stephen, or he was a witness to Stephen's death mm-hmm. at the time, right? And this is Paul, or Saul, writing about Moses way back yonder.
Right.
Right? Mm-hmm. In the old age. Saul is writing from the fifth dispensation, writing about that occurred with Moses in the fourth dispensation mm-hmm. of time. And he's expressing what Moses had to do or was told to do about this event. So we got to look at the what we're expressing is not new, but we're looking at it according to a spiritual purpose to see the blood. So read.
He took the blood of calves.
He took the blood of calves. Moses did that. And Saul is writing to us to let us know what that event was depicting, really. Keep reading.
And of goats with water and scarlet wool and hyssop mm-hmm. and sprinkle both the book and all the people.
Now, Moses is doing this with the book and all the people. Not at this, I'm not saying it's not at this specific time, but this is Moses that is doing this with blood. Keep reading.
Saying, this is the blood of the covenant which Yahweh has enjoined unto you.
Mm-hmm.
Moreover, he sprinkled likewise with blood both the tabernacle mm-hmm. and all the vessels of the ministry.
That's when they're dedicating this tabernacle that Moses is doing this with this blood, which was the first covenant, if you would. That's what they, the Jewish nations, were subject to, because they were just going to be a peculiar people at the then time mm-hmm. in the fourth dispensation. Mm-hmm. It has nothing to do with us having to fulfill or do or follow after the customs and traditions. You don't see a priest many times anymore going around with blood, throwing blood on people. That was an event in order to get one to now see that blood, when we see blood, that's going to be Yahshua. Mm-hmm. And then how that event, what they had to do is witnessing to Yahshua being that death. This is why we have this bloodline here, so we understand what the unity is going to be. Because when we see that all the events, when it's speaking of blood, you're going to understand that this is going to be part of the witness unto the one Yahweh, We heard John talk about in Revelations who was, who is, and is to come. There ain't nobody else coming. It's just the one, right? And he's already came, and we're looking for him to be in our hearts, in our minds, whereby we can understand the gospel, whereby we can express it to another. In order to do what? Because he said, what was he just read? I think it just read talking about he was going to be the first fruits of them to rise. Rise how? Rise according to a knowledge of him, according to the Spirit. And so when we read these things, we're being mindful. Are you down past 22 yet?
At that now.
Okay.
And almost all things are by the law purged with blood. And without shedding of blood is no remission.
There's no coming up to an elevated understanding. If you're not going to deal according to the pattern that's set up, and you need the blood first.
Right.
And you need the blood according to a tabernacle, according to a pattern. That's what it just said there, right? According to a pattern. He's referring to this pattern here, the tabernacle pattern. Because remember, when Moses saw this tabernacle, what do we say in the moderation? It's a invisible tabernacle or incorporeal. Because what? It's according to his vision of Moses. So we see this thing according to our mental state. We're not running around building this tabernacle and setting it up and setting it down. We're not going into a building anywhere.
Right.
Right? And so, therefore, we got to keep this tabernacle in mind according to the blood of the steps, the 3-in-1. Right? Got the 7 steps, the 3-in-1, the 9 furnishings, right, and the operation of all of those things. We're keeping that in our consciousness because as we go through our life, we're following that pattern. Right? According to a blood or death, a water or immersion, according to a veil here at this point here, or a spirit coming into an awareness mentally, a resurrection, because you're not going to get any. You might get better physically so at times, but eventually something else going to break down. Mm-hmm. So we're not looking at a fleshly resurrection, whereas you're just feeling good all the days, all the time. We're looking at a spiritual resurrection whereby we can operate in this holy place and be content and be at peace and ease because you have witnesses. Now no one can toss you to and fro according to whatever wind of doctrine they might want to bring to you.
Yeah.
Right? So let's try John 5:6. Now we got the blood principle down through here. First, John, you can do 19 and 34 when you get there.
1 John 5:6.
Mm-hmm.
This is he that came by water and blood.
Okay.
Yahshua, this is John, the Messiah.
This is John, the Revelator, who wrote Revelations we just heard about. And he said, this is he. Keep reading.
This is he that came by water and blood, Yahshua, the Messiah, not by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit that beareth witness, because the Spirit is truth.
It's the truth of about this blood and this water, about what it's doing and why we have this water here in order to bear record or bear witness of Yahshua the Messiah. And when we see how it was, that water was Yahshua the Messiah.
John 19:34.
So, at his crucifixion, we can see it displayed here. He's fulfilling. And you have him being pierced in the side. Yahshua Messiah. And he's already dead at this point. mind you, when you read, go back and read the story, you have the two on either side of him, right? And it was coming to toward nigh toward the evening, and they had to rush to get him off this stake. And we know that at that point in time, they broke the legs right. of the two that are on either side of Yahshua the Messiah, right?
Right.
And you understand how the crucifixion works. When they break the legs, they would sink in and therefore cut off that airway,
right.
you know, for a faster, obviously more painful death. Now your legs is hurt. You can't raise up or any kind of thing. And so but you know, when they came to Yahshua, he didn't break his legs. Because right, that's in the fulfillment of that lamb that couldn't be broken.
Right.
Right? And so now there's a witness to us of who and what he is. And so they had a, just for surety, they think that out came blood and water. No, that's just a double down witness of this event that has we're going to be transpiring. We got it right there. Of this piercing in his side with that staff, right? But that's a witness to what they had to do with that lamb here at the Passover, called kosher style in the Jewish culture, how they eat a certain type of food, meat primarily. They call it kosher. Well, that because they couldn't touch the blood. So they had to kill it in a certain fashion whereby you can drain that blood out so you don't have that kind of meat we eat, just wash it up and kill it, right? That's a certain kind of meat because of how they had to kill it or pierce that particular lamb in order to drain that blood. That's why he's in fulfillment of this event. Grab me John 1 and 29. Sean, you right there in the book of John in 1 and 29. You got to turn on the thing. There you go.
The next day, John seeth Yahshua coming unto him and saith, Behold, the Lamb of Yahweh, which taketh away the sin of the world.
Keep reading.
This is he of whom I said, After me cometh a man who is preferred before me.
That's good.
For he was before me.
So this is, and he was before John the Baptist. John's 6 months older than Yahshua the Messiah. But now John is saying, He was even before me. Right. That goes back to what John the Revelator said, that he was, he is, and he is to come. That's another witness to let you know that who we're dealing with is spiritual, is not physical at no time. At no time. Because that spirit was being down through Adam all the way down. Couldn't see him. It's got to be spiritual. Just turn it halfway down, then you'd be good. And so when you have Yahshua fulfilling, as we know, because when he come in, he's come in to fulfill. You still there? And go up the things to John 1 and... Yeah, keep reading there where you're at on 29, Sean.
Want me to go back to 29 or start at 31?
Start at 31.
And I knew him not, but that he should be made manifest to Israel. Therefore am I come immersing with water.
That's John the Baptist. He said he come and do immerse in water. We're on the water principle.
Right.
And John has to immerse in water because we read earlier that that law was set up that the man first got to die. That Moses with the tabernacle and sprinkle the blood on the people and the tabernacle, they get the blood witness, and you have John the Baptist. He's doing what they had set up way back yonder, baptizing the people unto Yahshua. Keep reading.
And John bore record, saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove.
Yeah, you're going to have to go back up to 23. I think it's 23 I want. Why Yahshua is here.
John 1 and 23.
Yeah.
John 1 and 23. He said, I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness. Mm-hmm. Prepare ye the way of Yahweh, as said the prophet Isaiah.
Yeah.
And they which were sent were of the Pharisees. And they asked him and said unto him, Why immersest thou then, if thou be not the Messiah, nor Elijah, neither that prophet?
Mm-hmm. Scroll down a little bit, John. So he's immersing Yahshua at this time. Now I lost my train of thought. Grab me Matthew 3:11. I need to pick up why Yahshua is doing these things. Matthew 3:11. I thought it was there in John.
Matthew 3:11.
Uh-huh.
I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance.
Yes.
But he that cometh after me is mightier than I.
Yes.
Whose shoes I am not worthy to bear.
Uh-huh.
He shall baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire.
See, it's going to be Yahshua that's going to be doing the baptizing with the Spirit and not with water and with fire. It's going to be Yahshua doing these things. Keep reading.
Whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner.
Mm-hmm.
But he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire.
So that fan, as we saw, or have we been shown that Dr. Kinley, when he saw this panoramic vision, right, of what Moses saw and what John saw, he saw that it opened up like a fan. And when it opened up as a fan, you can see how he captures this ages and dispensations, if you would. Because remember, he's coming in on the fourth dispensation. This fan's opening up from here. Because Yahshua is already going to pick up everybody from Adam unto himself. And now he's picking up us unto himself. So when he talks about that fan opening up, he's seen this whole creation, if you would. This week, if you would.
Right.
According to what he's going to garner. And this that's laying down, reread what he's going to be picking up.
And gather his wheat into the garner.
He's gathering his wheat. This is what's transpiring from that fan opening up. He's seeing this, read.
But he will burn up the chaff and unquenchable fire.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'll start with
and that's fine. So that's what Saul is expressing, right? Not Saul, I'm sorry. John the Baptist is expressing at this time about this wheat and this garner that's going to be picked up and wrapped up in Yahshua. Because Yahshua is fulfilling this fact. What was that in John? He picked up, suffered to be so now, John, for it suffices, I think, three. Suffices it to be so, John?
To fulfill?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
It suffices us to fulfill. Like John 3:32. Maybe it's it. That's the stuff from heaven, though. It suffices us to fulfill all righteousness.
John 3:32?
Just to talk about the dove, right?
Oh, Matthew. I'm sorry. Yeah. Okay. And Yahshua answered.
There you go.
And said unto him.
What is that you're reading?
Matthew 3, let me go 13 where I stop.
Okay.
Then cometh Yahshua from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. Mm-hmm. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me?
Mm-hmm.
And Yahshua answering and said unto him, Permit it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness.
That's Yahshua letting John know, who has the Holy Spirit, that he's bearing witness with John and let us fulfill all righteousness. That righteousness, remember, that righteousness was the law that was given to Moses. If they can fulfill the law of Moses, the Ten Commandments and the carnal ordinances, right? If they can do these things, it would be unto their righteousness. John is baptizing the children of Israel, the Israelites, because they couldn't keep the law. They were dead. They weren't right. If they could do it, they'd be good. Because Yahshua said, I have no sin. And John is saying, well, I need to be baptized of you.
Really?
Why? Because Yahshua gave them the law. Hey, it's like this thing they say, if you need the job done, you got to just do it yourself. And so now Yahshua just come, and now he's doing he's fulfilling these things because he is the only one who's going to be able to keep this law. Everybody else couldn't do that. And so this is why they were baptizing at that time with John the Baptist, in order to fulfill. And everything that Yahshua was doing or did do was in fulfillment of that which he had originally set up. All right? So that's the water principle, and we see how this laver works the same way. They had to wash, the high priest and two low priests had to wash in here. They had to wash that sacrifice in this tabernacle. Mm-hmm. For 40 years. They had to do that. Then also in the temple, they were washing the sacrifices as well, right? Because there was 10 of every kind in the temple about this blood, because there's a whole lot more people being sacrificed. We were having to account for their sins, right? This water here, the Red Sea, was accountable for that, because they were all buried in the cloud and in the sea, right? Mm-hmm. We get that in Hebrews. And you have the burial here of them being buried by the water, or the thought of that the water is coming, that principle of water that was shown to Noah what was going to be coming, and he had to preach to the people for 120 years. So that's principle of water. That's Yahshua coming. Don't think that was just for time then present. That's for us as a witness of what that water is that's bearing record. Now give me 2 Corinthians 3 and 16 and 1 John 5 and 8, Sean.
2 Corinthians 3:16.
Right. So now we're going to talk about this spirit. Okay? We got the blood. We got the water. Now we're going to talk about a spirit. And we see how this blood and water and the spirit is going to be working all the way down from the dispensations to Yahshua. So just read 1 Corinthians 3:16.
Mm-hmm. Nevertheless, when they shall turn to Yahweh, the veil shall be taken away.
Remember, there's a veil here on this tabernacle, right? We've got a first compartmental veil here. That when it is a little bit out of order. It seems like a little bit out of order here, but there's a veil that was here. You follow? And he's speaking about this veil. Keep reading.
Now Yahweh is spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And where the spirit of Yahweh is, there is liberty.
Liberty is freedom. Because this earth is what we're bound on as far as not understanding Yahshua. This was darkness, right? This mm-hmm. compartment here. Most holy place, and a court round about. We're residing on earth. It's equating to this state here of the migratory pattern, the greater, more perfect tabernacle. You have Egypt, typified by death or ignorance, divided by the Red Sea into the holy place, right? But here you're able to move around and have some liberty. You're not bound by Satan, if you would, or Pharaoh, if you would, of not knowing. At least you're moving around and seeing the light. You're seeing some bread, and you have an intercessor. This is where we can begin to learn about Yahshua the Messiah. Keep reading.
But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of Yahweh, are changed into the same image, from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of Yahweh.
And it's by the Spirit of Yahweh that we're going to change our consciousness in order to be able to bear witness to the Spirit. 1 John 5 and 8.
The Spirit, the water, and the blood.
Mm-hmm.
And these three agree in one.
Now it's going to be the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And they're going to be agree in the one Spirit. Yahweh is spirit, and those who go back, you guys still got 2 Corinthians there?
Nope, I left. Oh, yes, I do. So, which one?
3:16.
Okay. Nevertheless, when they shall turn to Yahweh, mm-hmm. the veil shall be taken away.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Yahweh is spirit. And where the Spirit of Yahweh is, there is liberty.
So it's that Spirit, when we turn and see about these witnesses, then we move into where these three bear witness on earth. You follow? And these three agree in the one Yahweh. These three, blood, water, spirit. When you see it according to the pattern of the death, burial, and the resurrection, you're beginning to see the operation of Yahshua. Grab me Isaiah. Give me 1 Kings 8 and 27, Eunice.
First King 8:27. But will Elohim indeed dwell on the earth?
Go up a little bit.
Okay.
Sorry. Just a little bit.
Therefore now.
Now we're in First Kings. We're in First Kings talking about David. Okay? David, the runt that slayed Goliath. Mm-hmm. And we're talking about what he's expressing. Read.
Therefore now, Yahweh Elohim of Israel, keep with thy servant David, my father, that thou promise him, saying, There shall not fail thee a man in my sight to sit on the throne of Israel, so that thy children take heed to their way, that they walk before me as thou hast walked before me. And now, O Elohim of Israel, let thy word, I pray thee, be verified, which thou speakest unto thy servant David, my father.
And so you have David. There's going to be a necessity to see an event. See that this word is going to be exposed or seen at some point in time. This is what he's expressing. I'm going to need Isaiah 66 and 1. Because now that we're coming up out of this blood, this water, this spirit, we're expressing these things that we can see. We can see that they did happen, right? According to an understanding that it's about Yahshua the Messiah. And now when we get up past the spirit, because now we're going to be looking back at phrases and comments that were expressed in order to see Yahshua. And we can see how he's going to unveil or reveal himself.
Isaiah 66 and 1. Thus said Yahweh, the heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. Where is the house that ye build upon me? And where is the place of my rest?
Now, this is Isaiah writing, but it's Yahshua asking the question. Where's this house at?
Right.
Isaiah know he ain't got worthy to no house. But it's Yahweh through, inspired by Isaiah, to write, where's this house?
Right.
Remember, David, we just read 1 Kings. You have to go through and get the continuity that David wanted to build a house for Yahweh.
Right.
In that thinking, in that time, in that dispensation. And when David didn't build it, Yahweh put it with the map, if you would, or the plans to build it, and gave it to his son for Solomon to build it. But that's no more different than Yahweh, pure spirit.
Right.
Right? Can't perceive him, can't understand him. Perceive that man weren't going to understand him, therefore divested himself into an incorporeal being known as Elohim, whom we say in the moderation, he chose for himself.
Right.
Father, son. David had the plans, and he gave the plans to Solomon.
Right.
It's a repeat. It's a pattern. I am Yahweh, and I change not. You got to keep up, because it's according to a witness. That's a witness.
Right.
Father has a business. Give it to Sanford and Sons. Hey, it was a junkyard, but what was the son's name?
Lamont.
Lamont was going to take his father's business. Lamont was going to take over the business. Like father, if you would. But this is just Yahweh doing it now. And he's doing the whole thing. Was, is, and is to come. Talking about Revelations. When John talked about that. Right? And so we're expressing that Isaiah is talking about a house. And where is this house going to be?
Right.
and Yahweh's asking, where is this house going to be? Where are you going to build this thing? Anything else there? Read.
For all those things hath my hand made.
Yahweh said, I made everything, and you're going to build me something that I made and already sanctioned?
Right.
Asher Iah. I will be whatever I will to be. He is everything. Therefore, you can't build him nothing. David, read.
Mm-hmm. And all those things have been, said Yahweh.
They've already been. They've already existed. Mm-hmm. We keep reading.
But to this man will I look, even to him that is poor mm-hmm. and of a contrite spirit.
Humble.
And trembleth at my word.
And fearful of his word. That's who he's going to want to, that's who he's going to want to dwell in and be with. Someone who's contrite and who is humble and fear him. You follow? Now, give me Matthew 5 and 35, please.
Matthew 5, 35.
Mm-hmm.
33. Again, ye have heard that it has been said by them of old
times. Now look, Isaac is old times. David is old times. And is Matthew now expressing, reread it.
Again, ye have heard that it has been said by mm-hmm. them of old times.
Okay.
Thou shalt not swear to a lie, mm-hmm. but shall make as unto Yahweh thy oaths.
By his oath, read.
But I say unto you, mm-hmm. swear not at all, neither mm-hmm. by heaven, for it is the throne of Yahweh.
The throne of Yahweh. Heaven's going to be the throne of Yahweh, read.
Nor by the earth, for it is his footstool.
This is the footstool. This information, this court roundabout, or the earth, if you would. It's just a footstool. And that throne, there's not a house you can build Yahweh. That's going to be sufficient for Yahweh. Mm-hmm. He's already here residing. His right. foot's already on the earth.
Yeah.
He's already sitting in heaven. He's already in your heart and in your mind. Just can't see him. Mm-hmm. We're going through some of the steps by which, with a hope, one might see where he's at. Right. Keep reading.
Mm-hmm. Neither by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. Mm-hmm. Neither shalt thou swear by thy head, because thou canst not make one hair white or black.
Can't do nothing. Can't do nothing without me. That's what he's saying.
That's right.
Can't build me nothing. I've done made everything. I change your hair from white to black. Keep
That's
reading.
Right.
Let's see what else he do.
But let your word yea be yea, and your nay be nay.
No, don't be lukewarm. Either know or don't know. Don't share something you don't know and understand and think that's of Yahweh. Read.
For whatsoever is more than these cometh of evil. Ye have heard that it has been said, an eye for an eye yep. and a tooth for a tooth.
Uh-huh.
But I say unto you uh-huh. that ye resist not evil, but whosoever shall smite thee on thy right cheek, mm-hmm. turn to him the other also.
Hmm.
And if any man will sue thee at the law and take away thy coat, let him have thy cloak also. And whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, go with him too.
So he's saying, hey, do whatever you need to do for anybody in order to get them to get an understanding of who and what he is and what you are. Don't worry about those things because you already have to come into that understanding and being in heaven, because we got to be in heaven prior to taking off the flesh, mm-hmm. consciously and psychologically. So, you follow? Grab me Acts 7 and 48. Then this is going to be Stephen. We're looking at Stephen, and Stephen's talking to these Pharisees and scribes, if you would, and they're listening to Stephen. Mm. 7:48 and 49.
Howbeit the Most High mm-hmm. dwelleth not in temples made with hands.
Stephen telling you he don't dwell in temples made with hands. Meaning the Ephesus that are all around the world. I don't care where you want to go, that's not where he's at. Read.
As said the prophet,
mm-hmm.
heaven is my throne.
Isaiah said that. Remember Isaiah having right. wrote in that spirit through Isaiah, because he's letting it be known that I said what Isaiah said. Read.
Mm-hmm. Heaven is my throne, uh-huh. and the earth is my footstool.
Mm-hmm.
What house will ye build me, saith Yahweh?
Mm-hmm.
Or what is the place of my rest?
Mm-hmm.
Has not my hand made all these things?
Mm-hmm.
Ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears.
In heart and ears to hear what? Read.
Ye do always resist the Holy Spirit.
They resist the Holy Spirit. And all we're doing is letting you know that what it is and what it's not. That's Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, about to be stoned. Remember Joshua said, if he hits you on one side, turn it and let him hit the other side. He's not bellyaching over it because he's already consciously gone.
Mm-hmm.
But he's letting them know the truth. Ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised of ears and heart to believe all that the prophets, what? The blood, the water, the spirit. Because that's all that's been preached. That's all that's been preached this whole time.
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's grab me 17 and 24 right quick. Acts 17 and 24. Then I'll be getting Isaiah 7 and 14.
Acts 17:24. Mm-hmm. Yahweh, who made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is ruler of heaven and earth, he dwelleth not in temples made with hands.
So that's letting us know there's nowhere you're gonna be able to go and dwell to escape or to pray or worship to Yahweh. Because it's not in temples made with hands. That's understanding that the earth is his footstool. Grab me Isaiah 7:14.
Isaiah 7 and 14. Therefore, Yahweh himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel.
Now, we've heard that 1,001 times. Christians use it. They express it. That's going to be the Jesus that's going to come in and fulfill, or not even fulfill, but bear witness to Isaiah's words. They think Isaiah's saying that, and that's all. That's the extent that they take that from. They don't know who Emmanuel was, because Emmanuel's not even a name; it's a title. What was Emmanuel? Elohim with us, right? Elohim with us. Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. All these three are one. So you got Elohim with them, and they don't even know it when he did appear. And so now we're going to read 9 and 6. Isaiah.
Isaiah 9 and 6.
Mm-hmm.
For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder.
Yep.
And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor of the Mighty El, of the Father of Eternity, the Prince of Peace.
He's the Father of Eternity. He's the one going to be sitting on the throne. That means he's not separate from God or the Lord. We're looking at the one Yahweh. And he's prophesying of himself that he's going to be coming. And he's going to be the counselor and ruler of all the world. I'm the Father of Eternity. Letting it be known right off the jump street who, where, and where he's at. But now see how if we see how this blood worked and this water worked, right, down through the events and time that we have in order to correlate them to. But now we're up here in this holy place, and we got one statement. The earth is his footstool. There's a lot of things that have bear witness to this fact of seeing who and what Yahshua Messiah is. Because now we're using these tools. We grant him some confidence that, hey, these guys weren't just saying things off the top of their head. They were expressing something. Give me John 14 and 8.
John 14 and 8.
We're in the holy place now. You got light, you got bread, you got intercessor. You got a pattern, an operation working here. You're having a belief now that the spirit, the water, and the blood are bearing witness on earth as we're on earth. But we're looking according to what the scriptures are saying. Read.
Philip saith unto him, Rabbi, show us the Father, and if sufficeth us. Yahshua said unto him.
Now, we went over this on Thursday. Sean did a beautiful job in expressing how they didn't believe in Yahshua. They didn't believe in the Holy Spirit. They didn't believe in the one in the counsel of the Father of eternity. Isaiah wrote about it. They were aware of what the scriptures are. Because we go to John 5 and 39, that the scriptures are about me. So they had the scriptures.
Right.
But they didn't know what Isaiah was talking about. Who's this Emmanuel?
Yeah.
Huh? They memorized it better than you and me. I can't even, sometimes I couldn't even find what, John 1 and 13 with this. But they were immersed in the scriptures, just like you said, Doc. And so they knew, but they didn't understand.
Right.
They didn't understand who Emmanuel was. When he was born, they wasn't looking to Isaiah. That's him. Yeah. They knew somebody was coming. Hey, because what happened with the 33 and a half years after he was born, when he comes to John the Baptist, they were asking, John, are you Elias? And we went over who Elias was, right, a couple of classes ago. And so we understand that he pointed them out too. Behold, the Lamb of Yahweh.
Right.
They didn't believe. That's why I say, those of uncircumcised ears and an uncircumcised heart to believe all that the scriptures have said or the prophets have said. They're not picking that up. That's why I say, after Pentecost, now we have the opportunity because of the divine vision and revelation that was given to Dr. Kinley for us to now see and point out this was more than just an Emmanuel. Far more than just Emmanuel. You follow? That's Elohim with us. At all time. Didn't go nowhere. And this is why we were expressing what John is talking about Philip not believing who Yahshua the Messiah is. And and when John and I talked about this, they wanted to do what? Read.
John 14 and 6.
14 and 8.
14 and 8.
Uh-huh. 8 to 11, and then to jump down to 20. Read.
Philip saith unto him, Rabbi, show us the Father, and it sufficeth us.
Yep.
Yahshua said unto him, have I been so long time with you?
Long time with you, Philip. Read.
And yet hath thou not known me, Philip? He that hath seen me hath seen the Father.
He that hath seen me seen the Father. We just read over there in Isaiah that he was the Father of eternity. But keep reading.
And how saith then thou then, show us the Father? Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me?
Oh, Isaiah, John 1 and 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with Yahweh. And the Word was Yahweh. But keep reading.
The words that I spake unto you, I spake not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me.
Now look, he say, believe him. That's Yahshua speaking to Philip. Believe me. But
I'm telling you.
They don't. But keep reading.
Or else believe me for the very work's sake.
For the miracles you see, because you're so carnal, you need physical things to aspire to believe me.
Right.
You need the miracles. You need to get through your physical ailment in order to believe and not just believe for the sake of the gospel.
That's right.
You need it for my work, because he did something, then I accept him. But I don't understand. That's still a problem. But nevertheless, jump down to 20. Verse 20.
At that day you shall know
that
I am in my Father, and ye in me, and
I
in you.
That means everybody going to know at that day. You letting it be known. You may not believe me, but let it be known that at that day, you're going to know. All
right? That's right.
Go ahead and keep reading.
He that hath my commandments.
Skip down to 27.
27.
Mm-hmm.
Peace I leave with you.
Mm-hmm.
My peace I give unto you.
They thinking he going somewhere. Remember, they're physical. When you say, I leave, you think he gone. But keep reading.
Yeah.
Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Mm-hmm. Let not your heart be troubled, mm-hmm. neither let it be afraid.
Keep reading.
Ye have heard how I said unto you, mm-hmm. I go away yes. and come again unto you.
Right.
If ye love me, ye will rejoice, because I go unto the Father.
Mm-hmm. And where's the Father at? See, he letting them know he's going away. And but yet the world think he going to go away yeah. to the Father. That's up there in the cloud. We just made reference of what the earth is his footstool, and right. where he is at.
Right.
He's in the kingdom. Huh?
The universe is the kingdom.
The universe is the kingdom?
And the air is the footstool.
Well, you have what? Three heavens. First heaven, second heaven, third heaven. And remember, this earth plane is the first heaven. The universe, as you're expressing, is the second heaven.
Atmosphere.
Yeah. Atmospheric heaven, right? And then you have the third heaven, which is eternity.
Right.
And eternity abides within all of this. This abides, these two heavens abides within eternity. So you're not coming out or going anywhere to
That's
get
right.
to eternity. You're already abiding in eternity. But it's the understanding about the eternity that gives you one solace and composure in the world, but not of the world. Because it's the way you're looking at the world. Because he's telling them, I'm going to leave. And I'm going to the Father. He already told them that the Father ain't no place. He's in the Father. If you go by the scriptures, scriptures say I am the Father of eternity. Eternity is in and out. That's what the cloud typified. When we say in the moderation. Where was this time? We have Yahweh had chosen this cloud to symbolize Himself because He had no discernible shape or form. This cloud is inscrutable. And incomprehensible. This is why he chose a cloud, right? And we drawn this cloud all the way around the edges of this chart. This is the whole world, if you want to call it that.
Right.
And the world is abiding inside of Yahweh or
right.
eternity.
That's
you
right.
follow? It's not separate than. You can't get out of eternity to look back at eternity.
Right.
You residing all within, and that's Yahweh. The atmosphere, the air you breathe, and then now you look at the air we're breathing, that's all around us, and it's all through you, too. Anybody stop breathing for about an hour and say, I just don't want to, take in no more air? Can you do it?
Yeah.
It's an impossibility just to suck up and say, I'm going to do this myself and breathe some kind of way. Hey, it's a miracle that you breathe day and night,
that's right.
nonstop,
that's true.
And you breathe the name of Yahweh, who is eternal,
absolutely.
In you and outside of you.
Absolutely.
We're coming to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as He truly is and actually exists, where He's truly at. He's talking to His boys now, talking about He's going to go away somewhere. And let's finish up what He's going to do.
Because I go unto my Father,
mm-hmm.
for my Father is greater than I.
Greater. Mm. Mm-hmm. He's greater than Yash. In understanding what he set out to do. That's still Yahweh.
He did it, yeah.
We can remember he broke himself in part. This right here, when he divested himself and became Elohim, that was not all of Yahweh. That's why he makes the statement. He's greater than I. I was created,
mm-hmm.
and I performed the will of my Father.
Right.
But I'm returning back to my Father, who is great. Right. I'm returning back to myself, which is the sum total of everything.
Right.
I'm greater than just me walking. Hey, this is just a physical man. I'm getting up out of here. I'm greater than this.
Right.
Because everybody think that this was all the bee's knees, right? And he hung them up on the cross. Where'd he go? That bee's knees that were hung up on the rock, that flesh, that was not Yahshua.
That's right.
But they named him. They called him Yahshua.
Mm-hmm.
But that was a physical body specially prepared. And once it performed its job, it's not as great as pure spirit. That's all I'm saying. That's what I say. I'm greater than.
Right.
Keep reading.
That's good.
And now I have told you before it came to, before it come to pass.
Prophesy. He told you, I'm telling you, before it comes to pass. Read.
That when it is come to pass.
And when it happens, that's why I didn't think he's just a prophet. He said a few things and it came to pass. But let's see what he asked, what it's going to be.
You might believe.
Might believe.
Mm-hmm. Hereafter, I will not talk much with you. Mm-hmm. For the prince of this world cometh, mm-hmm. and hath nothing in common with me. Mm-hmm. But that the world may know that I love the Father, mm-hmm. and as the Father gave me commandment, mm-hmm. even so I must do.
He was given a job to do. That's it. He was given a special repair body, that the bones weren't going to be broken, that he's going to be like an outcast dog. Beat and stripped and whipped. And gone through an horrific crucifixion, mm-hmm. for your sake, to understand who and what he come to do. I know. According to a spiritual law, a spiritual understanding. Not to profane and take vain of what he did. If you think he come and do to make you do these things, you calling him a liar. We have the pink book that Doc wrote out. It specifically makes clear that the clergy call Yahshua the Messiah a liar, because they what they call restored carnal ordinances. When he's come to say Matthew 5:17 to fulfill them, mm-hmm. he said he's not going to destroy the law and the prophets. The knowledge of those works of the Old and New Testament, or the Old Testament of the law and of the prophets, he's not going to destroy that, because that's all I'm using right now. Expressing to you of the events that have passed in the past. Not destroying the idea of it.
Right.
But we're not going to go back and do the actual ceremony of it.
Right.
That's it. When we get a psychological understanding about why Yahshua and what Yahshua did, according to the fourth dispensation, before they come to get him to crucify him, that's what we want to make clear. Rightly dividing the times of where we're at and what he's talking about. Who he's talking to. So you read down through 29. Grab me Romans 1 and 14 right quick.
Romans 1, 14. Mm-hmm. I am a debtor both to the Greeks and to the other nations.
Now look, this is Saul. He's a debtor to the Greeks and the other nations. Read.
Both to the wise and to the unwise.
To the wise and the stupid. Read.
So, as much as in me is, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also.
Hey, Saul saying he ready to preach the gospel to the wise and unwise, to the Greeks and to the Jews. Because he was a Jew and raised up under Gamaliel and was staunch in the law. Knew the law,
right.
Went and persecuted people because of the law, because they didn't do certain things. That's what he persecuted them, because they were following after the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah, which was the death, burial, and resurrection, which was the blood, the water, and the spirit. He told them these things to his disciples. Because when the day of Pentecost came, as we read in Acts, the second chapter today, the scripture, they were able to receive that Holy Spirit that came back after 10 days. Because remember, he said we went away, but then he also returned in the spiritual form now, in the hearts and minds of them that were able to perceive of what he did. These 12 boys here, or in fulfillment of the 12 tribes back here with Moses. And so when they walked around with Yahshua for some 3.5 years, then they were going to be able to be illuminated, just as we read in Acts. They rose up, Peter rose up and began to preach to, and they were confounded. They indeed heard the Spirit of Yahweh. Keep reading.
For I am not ashamed of the gospel of the Messiah.
See, it's of the Messiah. Remember I said that this blood is Yahshua. This water is, it ain't just the water event. It is Yahshua. The gospel is Yahshua. Read.
For it is the power of Yahweh unto salvation.
It is the power of Yahweh unto salvation. Salvation from what? Salvation from not knowing. That's what you're being saved from. And into is to know. And when you know, you have liberty. That's why you have liberty when you get past this veil. You're free to learn about your Creator. Otherwise, you're stuck. You're stuck in one aspect or the other, which is an opinion, a concept, a theory, or something that's corruptible or changeable or temporal. You're not sure which way to go because you have no witnesses to confirm yay or nay. If you can at least confirm yay, you can begin to learn and take on the nature of Yahweh. Or the understanding of Yahweh by way of his son, Yahshua the Messiah, by way of the gospel. Because this is what we have now to substantiate us coming and doing these things day in and day out.
Right.
Day in and day out. Moses this, and John that, and Dr. Kennedy this, and the panoramic that. What, we're just tooting our horn? No, we're giving witness and proof to that which has been already delivered, so that you can have faith in order to be saved from your consciousness. Mm-hmm. Keep reading.
Mm-hmm. For it is the power of Yahweh unto salvation to everyone that believeth.
Got to believe it. Read.
To the Jews first.
To the Jews first. See, this is why you have the Day of Atonement, or Pentecost. Excuse me, not Day of Atonement, but Pentecost on June the 6th. This was the first. To these Jews first. Read.
And also to the Gentiles.
All right, read.
For therein is the righteousness of Yahweh revealed from faith to faith.
And so what happened is to the Gentiles, we're speaking of Cornelius, right? 7 years later, and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit to the Jews first.
Right.
Then 7 years later to Cornelius at his house. He was the Italian band, if you would. And they had the outpouring Holy Spirit. And what did they get? They saw the meaning of Yahshua the Messiah. Peter went and talked to them and spoke to them like a man speaks to his friend. You know that boy Yahshua? Hey, and Cornelius, he already knew Yahshua. We went back and talked about that story about Cornelius was a soldier. You follow? Centurion. Centurion. He was a ruler of what, 100 men. And so he went to Yahshua and said, "Hey, dog, can you help my boy? He's sick back at home." Yahshua said, "I'll make it over there." "No, just speak the word."
"Yeah.
You just speak the word and I'm sure it'll be done." He had belief and faith. Didn't know, but he recognized we can see how he recognized Yahshua, put it that way. Right, Cornelius didn't know. Like we say, when I say no, he knew who Yahshua was. Like, he didn't know like that. But through this story, if you go back and read that, the centurion or Cornelius is recognizing, "Hey, just take the word. I know how this works." And so they later on he get back home. He healed, and now he back here. Now he can receive it. When Peter spoke to him, Cornelius received. "Oh, that's who and what that was in that guy. That's why I say, hey, just say the word and it'll be done." Mm-hmm. It's spiritual. And that's why Peter was the first of the Gentiles to have received. And he had already met Yahshua. Nah. 1 Timothy 3:16.
1 Timothy 3:16.
Uh-huh.
And beyond controversy,
whoa,
deep is the mystery of holiness. He who was manifested in human form, had his claim attested by the Spirit, was seen of angels, proclaimed among the nations, believed on in the world, and was received up into glory.
Reread that again for me, please.
And beyond controversy.
Beyond the controversy of this is right, that denomination, this God, or that God. We now know by way of the witnesses of the blood, the water, the spirit, that are pointing to the spiritual aspects from the fall of Adam, Adam dying in his consciousness, not knowing who Yahweh was, all the way down until Yahshua begins to come to fulfill all of that according to a spiritual understanding. There's no controversy with that, with me, with anybody else. That's the death principle. Mm-hmm. And it's the water principle that solidifies the righteousness of Yahweh. This is what it says. The witnesses, the law and the prophets, they're going to be unto the righteousness of Yahweh. You can have a Janus and Jammeries telling you all kinds of things. But we know without a doubt, without a structure, without a pattern, you're not going to go very far. Mm-mm. And then alone, Moses' rod or snake swallowed up their rods and snakes. Because there's a witness that's witnessing to this. It's not just a fun story. The principle is that all those lies that's been told are going to be swallowed up and eradicated. And this is going to go bye-bye. Because it's going to have already served its purpose. But if you're bellyaching and thinking that you're going to fight this, you got a dear problem on your hand. Because it's not to be fought. It's not to be won. What overcomes this is this righteousness, is the knowledge of Yahweh by way of the witnesses. And this is why we're going to be learning about uncontroversial. Back to read.
Deep is the mystery of holiness.
Great is the mystery of holiness. But keep reading.
He who was manifested in human form.
He Elohim. The first begotten was manifested, John 1:14, the word, we got the word Elohim, word or son, right, on the name chart.
Right.
This word, 1:14 of John, became flesh and dwelt among us. We're reading it. Timothy's talking about it. Read.
He who was manifested
to Timothy, but keep reading.
In human form,
mm-hmm.
had his claim attested by the Spirit when seen of angels.
Mm-hmm.
Proclaimed among the nations, believed on in the world, and was received up into glory.
Mm-hmm. And so this is when Saul or James, John saw this Elohim come up out of that water and that dove descend, he's looking at something. When a dove just flying down like a regular dove,
right.
It's the spiritual makeup that John knew that he was the Lamb of Yahweh that's coming to take away the sins of why he was burying those people. That's why he was out there with locusts and a bear in a wrapped in a like a wild man, right?
Right.
And that was only for a season that he was going to be doing that, because he knew that this one who's going to immerse you in you according to the Spirit, the fire and the blood. We read it earlier, right? When John expressed that there's going to become one greater than him,
right.
That he wasn't going to be able to tie his shoes, that he's going to be able to immerse you in the Spirit.
Right.
Well, that's what we're trying to express now, is through these understanding of why this is set up, so you have some foundation that become foundational work where you can stand up here and begin to see what Timothy is, or Saul is talking to Timothy about. Give me Hebrews 3:14. Mm-hmm.
Hebrews 3:14.
Yep.
For we are made partakers of the Messiah.
Now we are going to be partaking of a spiritual understanding. Not his body, not his old law and covenant, but a new heart of mind with an open ears and an open heart, so we can be partakers of Yahshua. Keep reading.
If we hold the beginning of our confidence.
The beginning of our confidence is blood, water, spirit. This is the beginning of our confidence. Uncontroversial. No controversy about this fact. That's what holds us down here. Mm-hmm. Because it's immovable. It's immortal. It's, what was the word? Principles. Immutable. It's immutable. They don't change.
Right.
That's the foundation.
Right.
Your house, you can paint your house add on to your house, but that foundation, that concrete or brickwork that you put down as your foundation,
right,
it don't move. Or you better hope it don't. Hey, your gospel, your preacher, your guru, your rabbi, you better hope that what they said to you sticks. You better hope that it's not changeable. Because when they come down here and we begin to teach the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah, we're going to be able to move that foundation in a heartbeat. Because you're not going to be able to say, I didn't know.
Right.
You can't tell me. I'm getting excited, but I'm just letting you know. If they're going to come to me that my creator, my savior is Lord, that's a problem. That's a lie. That's not a name.
Right. That's right.
And his son's name is not Jesus.
I ain't got
to go no more further than that. I'm not going to discuss any of this other stuff, and it, primarily if they're going to have contention, is all I'm saying. So this is a foundational thing that we're working with. You cannot tell me any of those names are names or that name means anything. It's an impossibility.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So keep reading.
If we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast until the end.
Mm-hmm.
Regarding the saying, today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts.
Harden not your hearts. Remember, you're supposed to be circumcised of your heart and of your ears. Yahweh said he's going to do that, but you have to believe in what he's expressing to you that he's actually doing. He's going to do the circumcising.
That's
with
right.
You believing that this one is going to overtake this one. Because this is what we're coming from and trying to get through to understand this one.
Right.
And it's Yahshua that's going to chip away at that hard heart, if you would.
Mm-hmm.
We're not like the children of Israel at thinking that we're forever stiff-necked and hard. We take on the semblance of that sometimes. But we have the ability to turn around and to accept. They didn't. We do.
Mm-hmm.
You just can't put yourself in the Israelite and say, well, I'm just stiff-necked and hard-headed. I don't want to know. Well, no, that's a contrite heart. But he's put a heart in you to know him. That's what you have the opportunity
to do.
And if it's just a little bit, that's a good thing.
Yep.
At least you know something that's erroneous. And
that's right.
I can't say it, but keep reading.
Harden not your hearts, as in the provocation.
Mm-hmm.
For some, when they had heard, did provoke.
Mm-hmm.
Howbeit, not all that came out of Egypt by Moses.
Hey, not all of them out of Egypt. Remember, all of them that did come out of Egypt, they all died. Those that didn't provoke with Caleb, Phinehas, and Eleazar. Them are the only three souls that were originally born down here and traversed this Red Sea.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he's speaking of. Who formerly were traversed, but there were some, save three, showing the unity of the Spirit, Yahweh, Elohim, Yahshua. That's what they're depicting. We ain't looking back and saying, I want to call my son Caleb because I just love that he was able to go over the River Jordan. That's not the case. The case is that Caleb, Phinehas, and Eleazar depicted the unity of the Spirit. Yahshua that went with them was guiding them.
Mm-hmm.
You follow? That was Yahweh. And you got those witnesses on earth crossing this veil or River Jordan or sixth step into the promised land. That's where we understand that this round trip was completed from the promise of Abraham,
right,
where they come down for 400 years and they come back up and tarry here for 40 days or 40 years and they cross over. That's a round trip, save three. They come up out of Egypt.
Yep.
Keep reading.
But with whom was he grieved 40 years?
I just talked about it. He grieved with them for 40 years because he's looking at this pattern going on.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
Was it not with them that had sinned?
Oh, yes, because they couldn't keep the righteousness of Yahweh. Remember, this is Moses, we read earlier, sprinkled them with blood, sprinkled the tabernacle. Do these things, you will be righteous.
Mm-hmm.
You will be holy. They couldn't do them. And Saul's letting them know in Hebrews, y'all can't do that. Y'all can't do that. That's why John came in baptizing until the sinful acts and the sinful ways that you couldn't fulfill the law. Keep reading.
Was it not with them that had sinned, whose carcasses fell in the wilderness?
All of them fell, save three. Keep reading.
And to whom swore he that they should not enter unto his rest, but to them that believed not.
They didn't believe. They didn't believe. That's why they tarried out here for 40 years. They went over here for momentarily for 40 days. They didn't believe nothing that they saw over here. They didn't believe none of the witnesses that they saw. They came back and told a lie. And just like your ministers come in telling you that your Savior is Lord. That's a lie. That's an unbelief.
Right.
When the name is clearly stated that it's Yahweh. Because you got a problem because you don't know how to teach in the name of Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. Because you don't have the Spirit in you. Because you deny the fact. You just can't say Yahweh to me no more. It don't mean nothing unless you can prove it and show it in some fashion. Because you many leave out Elohim altogether. That's a problem.
Yeah.
You done broke up the unity of the Spirit.
Yeah.
Of the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Got a problem. Yeah. Keep reading.
So we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief.
Of unbelief. They could not enter in. Now, it's Saul looking back at this event, not being able to enter in into the promised land. Because of unbelief. And none of them, save the three, were able to, after these 40 years of tarrying and suffering with them, to getting them to see who the manna was. That manna from heaven. You follow? Who was that brass pole that told Moses to hold up so they won't get bitten and die? All of that transpired out here was Yahweh himself showing and performing for them. With them. For us to see how it is. Because now it's our belief. We know they didn't believe. But what about our belief about that event? That's what we got to check and make sure that our own tub is safe and secure in the foundation of what we've been taught and what we've shown. You follow? Don't worry about the children of Israel no more. That was a type and a shadow.
Right.
Now the real thing is you. When we leave up out of here, you finish listening to this YouTube, and you got to go deal with the world, what nature are you going to have within you to compound this idea? You follow? That's set up for our learning. It's the only way it's got to be. Set up for our learning. Doc said, Dr. Kinney made an expression. He's an ally to me, but a problem for you. He's an asset for him and a liability for you. Based off of knowledge about it. That's it. Learn about it. Get to know about it. And see how it works according to a vision. It'll save your soul. Talked about saving earlier. Keep reading. Grab 14 and 13, please. 4 and 13. Same in Hebrews.
Hebrews 4 and 13.
Uh-huh.
Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight.
Mm-hmm.
But all things are naked and open unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens.
See, now all those things that were naked, we've all been naked back here. That's why Adam and Eve tried to put their clothes on. Try to cover themselves when they sin. They try to cover themselves, to hide. That's what they do when they use the wrong name. They hide. It is not them. Let me make it clear.
Mm-hmm.
We're not mad at the people or have issues with the people. It's the gospel that they speak. It's the way they think and how they perceive and understand who their Savior is. That's what we're looking at. And if that's contrary, then I can't have part with you in supping with you on that erroneous food, that erroneous concept. They call their gospel food, too. It's just bad food to me. You know, it's not substance. You follow? But then when we see how that nakedness, and we've been naked all the while, because Yahweh is expressing here that I see you. Keep reading.
That has passed into the heavens, Yahshua, the son of Yahweh, let us hold fast our profession.
Mm-hmm.
For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched mm-hmm. with the feeling of our infirmities,
mm-hmm.
but was in all points tempted, like as we are, yet without sin.
Yet we have this man. We're not going to get outside of this world because we're in the world. And therefore, he's not going anywhere because this is his right. domain. But yet, so that's why he's saying, we're going to have troubles. But because we have an understanding of one that can't be touched, which is Yahweh, and knowledge of him by way of his son, Yahshua the Messiah, we can overcome and we can endure these things. You follow? That was the end of that, right? So now when we're working up here in this holy place, if you would, and we're seeing how these events in time are pointing to Yahshua the Messiah and what he's set up to do by way of the bread and the light and the intercessing, we can see how that work, based off the foundation of blood, water, spirit, is going to allow us to be able to traverse that second compartmental veil. Because that's another step, right? And that is from a sixth step to the seventh step. And we go through here, and we grab me 1 John 5 and 7.
1 John 5 and 7.
King James Version, yeah.
For there are three that bear record in heaven.
Okay.
The Father.
Yes.
The Word. And the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
And these three are one.
See, it looks like they're separate up here, right? This is dealing with the most holy place. But when we come down and see how every event had a death, a burial, and a resurrection, or a blood, water, spirit within the story, the one story is pointing to the one Yahweh. And when we see and believe according to this one Yahweh, we can see how this Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, how these three are one. That's what we endeavor to get in this phase of the story. I think you had a good read.
And there are three that bear witness on earth.
Okay, we just went over that this entire class, what these things are on earth. Grab me Ephesians 4 and 1. 4 and 3, but start at 1. No. Ephesians 4th chapter, start at 1. Sorry. And I'll be right down. That's what we're looking at. These witnesses, this foundation, helps you to believe what you hear throughout the time in this class according to a structure or a pattern that we use in order to build our faith and our confidence in the one Yahweh. This is all we endeavor to do. Ephesians. And that's been happening since the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And now we're going to read Ephesians and hopefully conclude.
4 and 1?
Yes.
I therefore, the prisoner of Elohim, mm-hmm. beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called.
The vocation, the teaching with which you are called, the gospel. Mm-hmm. Being a prisoner to the blood, water, spirit, 40, which we said earlier is a foundation. It's unmovable. It's unshakable. It's indisputable. Then you become a prisoner to that. In order to what? Edify and teach and become an ambassador to that. But keep reading.
With all lowliness and meekness,
uh-huh.
with long suffering,
yes.
forbearing one another
yes.
in love.
In love, in the teaching of the gospel of Yahshua Messiah. That's the true love. That's the only love that there is. Everything else is a type and a shadow of the love of preaching the gospel. And get edifying someone's soul from an ignorant state or an unknowing state into a knowing state. That's all that we're here to do. We're just a vessel in a body. Opening, listening to that, what thus saith Yahshua the Messiah, based off what we've been taught. Keep reading.
Endeavoring to keep the unity yeah. of the Spirit that's and the bond of peace.
That's what we do. We endeavor to do that in peaceful, in the teaching, in demonstrating, showing you if you believe and accept the fact. Keep reading.
There is one body mm. and one spirit,
mm.
even as ye are called in one hope of your calling.
Mm-hmm.
One Elohim,
yes.
one faith,
yes.
and one baptism.
Yes.
One is Yahweh and Father of all,
mm-hmm.
who is above all and through all and in you all.
That's what we expressed earlier. Remember this cloud? Above all is in eternity. He's in you, through you, and in you all.
Yep.
Keep reading.
But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of the Messiah.
It's a measure of the gift of being able to preach and share the gift of the Yahshua, the Messiah. Read.
Wherefore, he said, when he ascended up on high, he took captive captivity and gave gifts unto men.
Hallelujah. If you got anything I would say today, I'll praise the Yahshua, the Messiah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Love. That will conclude today's lecture. We got an announcement. Dr. Kennaway Kleinsmith had a stroke when she was up in Mammoth recently with her family. She was hospitalized. She has since been released from the hospital, and she's resting comfortably at home with Dr. Will Williams at this time. So we have a card for her that will be available, a Get Well Soon card, in the lobby for you to sign, and we can send out to her. And our hearts and our minds and our thoughts are with her as she recovers. So we hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California, on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m., and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring all your friends and all your enemies, because this is truthfully the place where you can learn something true about your Heavenly Father, Yahweh. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah.